Welcome,
everyone.
Hey, thanks for joining us online wherever or whenever you are watching this. Welcome. We are glad that you're here. Well, here's a question that every single Christian needs to think about at some point. It's this. What is the faith of the next generation worth? The data is in, and it's not looking good for churches. Younger generations, once they leave high school or college, they're not returning to the church like they used to. So what are we going to do about it? Because if we're going to keep doing the same things, we're going to continue to get the same results. So stick around. Get ready to be pushed out of your comfort zone a bit as we explore some new ideas.
Okay, that sounds very intriguing. I can't wait to find out about it. For now, we have some big, exciting news to share with you all.
Yes.
God continues to bless us with new guests each week, so much so that we are excited to announce, starting next Friday, July 2nd, we are moving to 2 in-person services at 10 a.m. and 12 p.m.
Nice.
If you're a family with kids, make sure to come to the 10 o'clock service when we have the full kids program. We really are so excited about what God is up to here at Mosaic and look forward to welcome every one of you in our gathering.
Yeah, it's going to be amazing. It's so exciting, and there is not a better song that expresses how I feel about all this than what we're going to sing right now.
At the raging sea, our God, He holds the victory. Saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause He hung up on that cross, He rose up from that grave. My God's still rolling stones away. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're shout out your praise.
There's joy in the house of the Lord.
Well, that chorus says it all. There's joy in the house of the Lord, no doubt about that. Well, today, I'm excited to introduce our speaker for the day. For many of you, he needs no introduction at all. He's our partner church speaking pastor, and really, he's one of the most famous preachers in the world. He's the author of over 20 books, and today, he's going to give us an insight into one of his latest, Reclaiming Irresistible. Andy Stanley is going to share why he changed his approach to preaching. For some of you, if you're like me, you're going to be pushed outside your comfort zone with this message. It's going to make you feel a little uneasy, but stick around to the end and you will see Andy's heart as he's addressing one of the biggest problems the church has today. It's answering the question, what is the faith of the next generation worth? It's the reason why Andy changed his preaching style, and it's why we here at Mosaic have been changing the way we do our church services.
Today, what I wanted to do, and it's a little bit awkward, so I hope you'll trust me. I wanted to spend a few minutes talking to all of our churches to give you the backstory of my book, Irresistible. And I promise I'm not trying to sell books. In fact, if you've been here for very long, I never talk about my books in church. The only time I ever talked about a book was once I gave everybody a copy, but we were much smaller then, okay? I would have to get a second mortgage on my house to buy you all a book. So the point of talking about this today to all of our churches is that you are very much a part of this book and very much a part of this journey, and I didn't want to miss an opportunity to talk about that for several reasons. You don't even really need to read it, because to some extent we have all, for those of you who've been here for a long time, we have experienced this together. 23 years ago next month, we're coming up on our anniversary, 23 years ago next month, we came together to do something unusual. We decided that we wanted to create a church that unchurched people would love to attend. And I had never been in a church like this, and those of you who've been on this journey with us for a while, you'd never been in a church like this. We were told in the Southeast you couldn't do this because the Southeast was so churched, if you tried to do something different, people would just be critical. And they weren't completely wrong about that. And our goal, this is very important, our goal was not to create a church for unchurched people. Our goal was to create a church for church people that unchurched people would love. For Christians who were concerned about their neighbors, and for Christians who were concerned about that brother-in-law that just wasn't going to go back to church, and for Christians who were concerned about the people they worked with and the people that they went to school with, and primarily, I should say, this was for a church for people who were concerned about the next generation, a church where seekers and starters and returners could seek and restart and return. And so we realized early on, and many of you were with us at the time, we realized that if we were going to reach people that nobody else was reaching, we were going to have to do some things that nobody else was doing. And whenever you do things and other people aren't doing, and whenever you're the first, people are a little bit concerned. In fact, they sit up straight and they pay attention, and it's easy to criticize. In fact, it's human nature to criticize things that you don't understand, and it's human nature to criticize things that you cannot control. But we decided, in spite of that, because of the Great Commission, we were going to reach people that nobody else was reaching, and we were going to take a chance and do some things that nobody else was doing. And we did. And when I say we did, I mean we did. I mean you did. And we were criticized. I'll never forget when we were meeting at Dunwoody Baptist Church over in Dunwoody on Sunday nights. We met for the first 3.5 years every other Sunday night. I can remember looking as I was preaching and seeing pastors that I knew from the area, from the Atlanta area, not sitting, standing in the back with staff like this, watching our service, and about halfway through the sermon, they would leave. So they just had to come and make sure, yeah, this isn't going anywhere, and they would leave. Nothing to see here, nothing to learn here. And I was always so curious about why they weren't any more curious. But they weren't curious, and that's okay. But it didn't matter because we did some things nobody else was doing to reach some people nobody else was reaching. And it worked, and it multiplied, and we went multi-site, and we went, you know, internet. And, you know, it's just been absolutely incredible what's happened. And not only have we've grown with the right kinds of people. We've grown with people who were far from God. And many of you, we are a part of your story. You were baptized here. You raised your kids here. Today at North Point, I looked up on the stage and half the band, these were guys that were pretty much born or raised in our church who are now, you know, second generation coming back around to serve the local church. It was amazing. In 2005, we did a conference called the Drive Conference. And we've done it every other year since 2005, where churches from all over the country, now all over the world, come to our campuses to see what we're doing and to learn from us. In fact, this May, we're doing Drive Conference. If you're watching from another church, we'd love to have you. Registration opens, I think, October the 11th. And we would love to host you, you and your whole staff. And we're just going to do show and tell you and say, you know, basically, this is what we've learned over the last 2 years, because we so love the local church, and we've never been afraid to do things that other people weren't doing in order to reach people that other people weren't reaching. Now we have partner churches all over the country, and Athens Church and Southside Church and Southside Noonan, all over the country. My wife is in Colorado this weekend speaking at our church in Colorado, an extraordinary church. And so this has just gone on and on. Now we have a network of churches, and it's been absolutely amazing. But in the early days, in fact, we continue this, but in the early days, the thing that set us apart from other churches is that we were focused on the church environment. In fact, we had three things that were guiding kind of lights as we established these churches all over the city and all around the country. We wanted appealing settings. That's why the first time you came here, if you'd come from a traditional church, it was like, wow, you know, it feels more like home than a church. Engaging communication. It wasn't enough to tell the truth. We wanted to tell the truth in a way that was engaging, especially for middle school students, high school students, college students, and adults. And helpful content. This was the thing I was always just banging the table about. Hey, it was true, but was it helpful? It was true, but was it helpful? And our goal was not to make church easier or more interesting for church people. Again, it was to make it more appealing and more engaging for people who had left the church, who had walked away from the church, or who were considering faith for the very first time. And you led all of this. You modeled all of this. You funded all of this. You were uncomfortable with all of this, some of you, and you got involved with all of this. And consequently, we've been very, very, very successful in terms of numbers and in terms of influence. But while we were busy doing all those fantastic things, things that we are going to continue to do, by the way, today is not we're going in a different direction. It's not that at all. We're going to continue to make it better. We're going to continue to make it as interesting as possible and as engaging as possible. But while we were busy doing all of that, our world changed. Our world changed because of the internet. And because of the internet, now all the information and the misinformation in the world is at everyone's fingertips, including children, middle school students, high school students, and college students. What you may not know is this, that after 9/11, 2001, after 9/11, after we were, you know, the World Trade Centers were attacked and our country was attacked, following that, in fact, in the 2 or 3 years following that, there was a firestorm of religious skepticism that swept our country. Initially, it was anti-Islam skepticism, but now, very, very, very quickly, it turned into skepticism about all religion. And some very witty, very educated, and very convincing atheist authors published several books and sold millions and millions of copies. They became rock stars on university campuses. They became rock stars in debates. And unlike years before where you had to buy a ticket and attend a debate, unlike years before where you had to buy a ticket and drive to a city and actually show up on a university campus to hear someone speak, those days are long gone. And suddenly everybody in our country, everybody in the world, but everybody in our country had access to all of this misinformation as this group of people began to really war against all religion. And over time, it turned to Christianity in particular. And it fueled the rise of something that many of you, most of you know about, but all of you should know about. It fueled the rise in our country of what are called the nuns, the N-O-N-E-S, the people who are religiously unaffiliated. Currently, and all of this happened while we're working hard and creating churches and baptizing kids and doing all this cool stuff, right? Currently, about 25% of everybody in America, 25% of Americans would consider themselves religiously unaffiliated. Now, that's a high number, but the staggering statistic and the thing that bothers me, and I want it to bother you, is this. In 2007, it was just 16%. 16% to 25%, that is millions and millions of people. And the thing that bothers me the most and the thing that I want to bother you the most is this. That 35% of men and women, 35% of men and women who are under 35 years old consider themselves religiously unaffiliated, and most of them grew up in church. Most of them grew up going to camp. Most of them grew up hearing the same kinds of sermons that many of us heard growing up. And maybe most alarmingly of all is this, that 70% of the unaffiliated, the nuns, the non-religiously affiliated, about 70% view the Bible as completely irrelevant. Ancient myth, ancient literature, certainly not inspired. And more and more and more, there is a movement to argue that the Bible is not only a fiction, that the Bible is harmful. And when this group of people are surveyed, and the Pew Research Center does these surveys every other year, and they get more and more and more statistics, at the end of the day, when this group of people are asked, why did you leave your religion? Why are you religiously unaffiliated? Why did you walk away from your local church? Why did you walk away from a church you grew up in, that your parents grew up in? There's many, many presenting reasons. But at the bottom of it all, the primary answer is simply this. They just don't believe any more. And I'm going to pause there and say this. For some of you, this is not somebody out there somewhere. This is the story of your children, isn't it? This is the story of your grandchildren. This is what happened to your sister-in-law, your brother-in-law. And you just don't understand it because they heard all the things you heard. They believed all the things you heard, believed. And now when you have conversations with them, it's like they're not even antagonistic. I mean, they're not even defensive. They just basically say, that's good for you. That's your truth. I don't believe it anymore, and you can't even figure out what it is they don't believe anymore, and you can't figure out why they don't believe it. For others of you, you are right in the middle of this with your children or your grandchildren, your college son, your college-age daughter, your son or daughter, or your niece or nephew that's in graduate school. And fueling this mass exodus is this, that once upon a time, a person had to read the Bible to know what was in the Bible. Once upon a time, when most of us grew up, if you wanted to know what was in the Bible, you actually had to go find one, borrow one, steal one out of a hotel, drawer. Imagine stealing a Bible. That's kind of weird, you know? When I was a kid, my dad's pastor, he was parked in his reserved parking spot at First Baptist Atlanta, and somebody broke in his car and stole his Bible. It's the only thing they stole. I thought, what are they going to do, read it? Thou shalt not steal, huh? Look at there, Anyway. The point being, the only way to find, in the old days, the only way to discover what was in the Bible, you had to have one in your hands and read it. And most people in a bygone age respected the Bible even though they hadn't read it, and most people hadn't read it. In fact, your experience is like mine. Some adult, when you were a child, they gave you your first Bible. They said, this is God's holy word. It's all true. And you believed it was all true, and you had not even read it. And I'll let you in on a little secret. Let's keep this in the room. Chances are, the adult that handed you your Bible and told you that it was all true, they hadn't read it all either. But that's just the way our culture worked, because everybody had so much respect for the Bible. Very few people read it. We left it to priests and preachers to tell us what was in it. But those days are long gone, because now you, your kids, your grandkids, and the future generation and this generation can discover what else is in the Bible without even owning or opening or touching a Bible. This calls for a different approach to what we're doing. And post 9/11, this created the perfect storm, the perfect opportunity, and skeptics exploited a flaw in the modern version of Christianity, because they had something that previous generations of atheists and skeptics didn't have. They had the internet. They had an all-access pass to every single curious person in the world. And they have leveraged this extraordinary tool to preach their gospel of disbelief to undermine the credibility of Christianity. And they have exploited a flaw in our modern post-Reformation version of Christianity, a flaw that is very difficult, almost impossible to exploit in a culture that holds the Bible in high esteem. And the flaw is simply this. It's a false assumption. It is a shared false assumption regarding the foundation of Christianity. And when I say a shared assumption, I mean this, that Christians assume this, non-Christians assume this, post-Christians assume this, your son and daughter or grandson or granddaughter that walked away from faith assume this. If you're considering losing faith or dismissing your faith or walking away from faith, this is something that you assume as well. And this false assumption that has been with us since the Reformation has finally begun to take root, and we're finally paying a price for it. And it's why I wanted to talk to you about it, and it's why I wrote the book, Irresistible. Since the Reformation, and we're not going to go back and do a lot of history, but since the Reformation, Protestant leaders, teachers, and preachers have taught that the Scripture is the final authority for Christians. This was the whole point of the Reformation, that the church isn't the final authority, that the Scripture, the Bible, is the final authority for Christians. In fact, we, most of us, grew up hearing that or thinking that, and even if you didn't grow up in church, you assume, well, the Bible is marching orders for Christians. So consequently, for generations and generations and generations, preachers have said, the Bible says, the Bible says, the Bible says, the Bible teaches, the Word of God says, the Word of God says, and when you hear the Word of God says and the Bible says, basically what they're communicating is, at the end of the day, the bottom line is, if the Bible says it, that's all we need to know. If the Bible teaches it, we believe it. If the Bible says it, then that settles it. And that kind of language, generation after generation after generation, has left generations of Christians assuming that the Bible is the foundation of our faith. Don't leave early. It's not, and it never has been. But most modern Christians think it is. Most of the Christians that left church thought it was. Most of the generation that walked away from church walked away from church assuming it is. And modern skeptics and those that are undermining the Christian faith assume that it is the foundation of our faith as well. And this assumption has left many with the impression, and understandably so, that as the Bible goes, so goes the Christian faith. If you can undermine the credibility of the Bible, all 66 books, or any one of the 66 books, or any part of any one of the 66 books of the Bible, that Christianity comes tumbling down. As you've heard me say before, it's like a 66-card house of cards. And we're going to pull out Genesis, or we're going to pull out Leviticus, or we're going to pull out something in Revelation, or we're going to pull out some supposed, you know, contradiction in the resurrection stories out of the Gospels. And if one part of it isn't true, then the Bible isn't true. And if the Bible isn't true, Christianity is false. In fact, one of the most prominent new atheists, in the introduction to one of his books, I'm not going to mention his name or the book right now, we're going to talk about that in the series to come. In the introduction of the book, he says this. He says, come on, Christians, this is how it works. If Christianity is true, then I have a frightful surprise waiting for me when I die. But if the Bible is false, then Christianity is false, and you're all living a fairy tale. This is the assumption of the modern church, and I understand how we got there, and I'm not being critical of anybody, but the time has come for us to call out and draw a circle around this false assumption. Not for our sake, I'm fine. Not for your sake, you're probably fine. For your children's sake, for your grandchildren's sake, for this generation's sake, and for the sake of the next generation. And with the help of the internet, the skeptics have done a masterful job exploiting this false assumption about Christianity. And what has the church done? How has the church responded? In my opinion, the church has done nothing. Churches preach and teach as they've always preached and they've always taught. They keep preaching the same way. They just tell children, here's your Bible. It's all true. Believe it. The children believe it because the children will believe anything adult tells them to believe. But most adults haven't read the Bible. They just assume it's all, you know, it's since, you know, the way, because of the way they received it, they've held on to their childhood view of the Scripture, and consequently they hand that off to another generation. And then they graduate from high school and we send them into an increasingly post-Christian culture. And when they come home with real academic questions, we give them Sunday school answers, and no wonder they're walking away from faith. Now, there is a group that has responded to all of this, some Christian authors and apologists, and they've written many, many books defending the Bible. And I think, I'm not exaggerating, I think I have read every single one of their books. Ask my wife. It's all I listen to because I love apologetics and I love this stuff. But here's what I know. You are not going to get a 25-year-old, a 22-year-old, or your brother-in-law or your sister-in-law to wade through a 250-page book, and when that didn't answer all their questions, give them another 250-page book. So if you're really interested in knowing how to defend the Bible, there's lots of information. But you're not going to get anyone's undivided attention for that long. And somebody has to be really interested. Somebody has to be looking for something to substantiate their faith to wade through those fabulous books. Given enough time and interest, you can defend the Bible. So years ago, I decided that's not the best approach, even though I love those books and recommend them all the time. And in our next series, I'm going to recommend two or three of those books to you. Years ago, I was watching one particular atheist do an incredible talk at a university. It wasn't a debate. He was just speaking. And the crowd was going wild. I mean, he was completely dismantling the Old Testament, dismantling parts of the New Testament. You know, Christian, the Bible is false. The Bible has contradictions. The Bible can't be trusted. And as the Bible goes, so goes Christianity. And the crowd was just cheering. And I sat watching him on my computer, and I thought, I got to do something. And I don't think I want to spend the rest of my life teaching apologetics and trying to prove to people that the Bible is true, because what we need to do, what I feel like I need to do, was address the fatal flaw. The fatal flaw that as the Bible goes, so goes Christianity. So about 8 or 9 years ago, I changed my approach to preaching and teaching. I didn't announce it. I didn't come in here and explain all this because I was just still trying to figure it out. I didn't mislead anybody. Contrary to some people's opinion, I did not change what I believed. In fact, just the opposite, just so you know. I am more convinced than ever that following Jesus will make your life better and make you better at life, and you should follow Jesus. Even if you don't believe, you should follow. I'm so convinced of that. I'm more convinced than ever. In fact, I don't know why everybody wouldn't want the message of Christianity to be true. I just don't understand why people who are skeptical and people who don't believe wouldn't be asking, okay, I don't believe, but as the, you know, the person that, one of the people that Jesus healed in the Gospels, he said, help my unbelief. I want to believe it's true. I want to believe that in the end, everybody gets justice. I want to believe that in the end, there's forgiveness. I want to believe that in the end, there's a personal God who's invited me to call him Father. Why wouldn't everybody want that? I'm totally sold out to the message of the gospel, the message of Jesus. And not only did I not change what I believe, I didn't change my view or my respect for the Bible. None of that changed. But what did change was my approach to talking about the Bible. I stopped saying anything that would support this notion that as the Bible goes, so goes Christianity. And I embraced what I believe is the approach of our first century brothers and sisters, as it relates to faith. And their approach was this. It was an approach that argues from and anchors to the event of the resurrection rather than the authority of the Bible. And I've been preaching to you and teaching this way for about 7 or 8 years, very, very, very intentionally. And the reason I feel so confident about this is because this was the way the first and second century Christians survived and how the church thrived. Because Long before there was Christian scripture, there were Christians. And not just average Christians, not the kind of Christians you are, or the kind of Christian I am, or the kind of Christians that we know. Extraordinary men and women who were sandwiched in between the Jewish temple and the Roman Empire, and somehow they survived and their faith thrived and it spread throughout the empire into the lands of the barbarians. They had a faith, as you've heard me say, stronger than Roman steel, tougher than Roman nails, to which many of their friends were nailed to Roman crosses because of their faith in Jesus. And here's what's indisputable. Today, Rome is full of crosses commemorating the death of Jesus, the city of Rome. And the city of Jerusalem is full of Christian tourists. How did that happen? What did they know that we don't know or have forgotten? So I've done my best in these past few years to step back and to teach and to preach from the standpoint of anchoring your faith and the faith of your students and the faith of our churches to the event of the resurrection rather than the authority of Scripture. It began with a series that some of you were here for called Christian. Some of you remember that. 2 years later, brand new. 2 years later, tough as nails. 2 years later, last 2 years ago this fall, who needs God? This spring, 90, or after 90, aftermath. I've not spent every single sermon or every single series doing this. We need to talk about practical things, but I've done my best to bring you back and to try to lead you into this more formidable faith, the faith of our first century brothers and sisters. I stopped saying a long time ago, the Bible says, the Bible says, the Bible says, the Bible says, and what I did instead is I tried to draw your attention to the people in the narratives. James, every time I teach from James, I say, James, the brother of Jesus, what would you have to do to convince your brother that you were the Son of God? And everybody chuckles. And I'm like, that's James. When James died for his faith, he died believing his brother was his Lord. What did James know? Let's look at James. Instead of the Bible says and quoting James. Peter, who betrayed his best friend and then he had to face his best friend. We all know what that feels like. Let's see what Peter has to say. John, who introduced us to the idea that God is love. And John did not believe that life was lovely or the world was lovely or culture was lovely. But John, who stared into the eyes of love, who stared into the eyes of Jesus and determined, this man is God in a body. And if God is anything like this man, and if this man is anything like God, and if this man is God, God is love. And I've done my best to draw you into the history behind the narratives and to focus and to anchor your faith to the event of the resurrection. How many times have you heard me say this? If someone predicts their own death and resurrection and pulls it off, I go with whatever that person says. I have said this every single chance I get, and I'll tell you why. Because when you begin to doubt, and your son or your daughter begins to doubt, I want you to know that you can anchor your faith and their faith not to the 66 books of the Bible, but to the event that launched this thing to begin with. Every Easter for the past 5 Easters, I've begun our services the same way. I've said this. Hey, if you're here today and this is your first time in one of our churches, here's what we want you to know. We believe that Jesus died on the cross and rose from the dead, but not because the Bible tells us so. It is better than that. I've said that the last 5 Easters in a row. Why? Because I want to anchor people's faith, and I want you to anchor your faith to the event of the resurrection, not the 66 books of the Bible. Do I think there's anything wrong with the 66 books of the Bible? No. This is not about me. This isn't even about you. This is about a generation we're losing, that we're losing unnecessarily, because I'm convinced 99% of the people who have walked away from faith did not walk away from anything that had anything to do with the essentials of our faith. And that has to change. And I want all those people to come back, because I believe that following Jesus will make your life better and make you better at life. The first century Christians, the second century Christians, they knew what we either didn't know or have forgotten, that the foundation of our faith is not "it is written." The foundation of our faith is "something happened." Our epic story does not begin in Genesis. Our epic story begins Easter morning, when disheartened and sad and brokenhearted and disillusioned men and women stared into an empty tomb and met their resurrected friend and rabbi who they would later declare as their savior. Our story, come on, your story, your children's story, our grandchildren's story does not hang in the balance of whether 66 ancient documents are all accurate at every level and can be proven true. The story of our faith hangs on a single event. Now, if you think I'm making this up or I'm discounting the importance of Scripture, please pay attention. In fact, the Apostle Paul, who brings us about half the New Testament, said it best. The Apostle Paul, in the book Irresistible, I spend a lot of time on this. The Apostle Paul, who, and this is unimaginable, in the course of a day, went from a law-abiding Pharisee who was so committed to the law and the temple that he was rounding up Christians and having them tortured and executed. In the course of a day, he went from a law-abiding Pharisee to a Jesus follower in one day. And when the scales fell from his eyes, he not only could see physically, he had extraordinary clarity about the contrast between the old covenant and the new. And the Apostle Paul himself says, there's only one thing that serves as the foundation of our faith. And if this goes away, our faith goes away. And it was not something written. Here's the words of the Apostle Paul himself. This is big. He said, and if Christ has not been raised, our preaching is useless. And so is your faith and 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 your faith. So wait, Paul, that's kind of risky. I mean, you're saying the whole thing teeters on a single event? Paul would say, yes, do not be mistaken. This is not the it is written religion. This is the something happened religion. And if this happened, game on. God has done something in the world for the world. And if this did not happen, ignore my preaching and ignore your fairy tale faith and go back to the temple or go back to your polytheism or your paganism, because Christianity is not true. Christianity rests on a single event. And the Apostle Paul did not say this about anything else. The Bible did not create Christianity. I want the next generation to know that. I want them to know if they decide to walk away from the Christian faith, they're not walking away from a book. They are walking away from an event that has been documented, and more importantly, they are walking away from a person. Just as the Constitution did not found our nation, just as the company handbook did not start your company, the Bible did not launch Christianity. Put it a different way. Your birth certificate didn't birth you. Your birth certificate documents you. And if your mother is still alive and I were to ask her, what's more important to you, the document or the birth? Hopefully, she would say, the birth. When people came to the hospital after your mother had you, nobody asked to see the birth certificate. They wanted to see the baby. And the thing I love about you and I love about our church, for 23 years, we've been showing people the baby. And I say we keep doing that. And if it means we have to do some things that other people aren't willing to do to reach some people that other people aren't reaching, that's what we do, because that's what you have always done. The baby that showed up as an adult man on the banks of the Jordan River. And John the Baptist looked at him and said, oh no, or oh yes, or oh good, or oh my, it's about to happen. The promise given to Abraham all those years ago is about to come true right here in our generation. Behold, the final Lamb of God who has come to take away the sin, your sin and my sin, the sin of the whole world. The baby who grew to be a man, and the Apostle Paul would say about him later in Ephesians 2:20, and if you doubt what I'm saying, you need to look up Ephesians 2:20 later. You know what the Apostle Paul said about Jesus? He said, the foundation of our faith is a person, Jesus. The cornerstone, the very first stone laid, the thing that determines everything else about the building, the foundation of our faith is not it is written. The foundation of our faith is something happened. God sent his son into the world. The same baby that grew to be a man that after his resurrection would gather his closest followers. And he would say something that was just crazy. Nobody would say this unless there was some evidence to back it up. And they'd seen him die. They knew where he was buried. Several of them had breakfast later with him on the beach. And now there he was alive in front of all of them. And he makes a statement that I hope you'll wrestle with. He says, no, but who would say this? All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. Do you know what the final authority for your life as a Christian is? It's a person. It's Jesus. My final authority is Jesus. The foundation of my faith is Jesus. And nobody loves the Bible in this room or listening more than I do. In fact, one of the great things about being an empty nester, not to make you jealous, but Sandra and I can get up early in the morning with our coffee and we can read our Bibles longer, and we are such nerds. We sit around and talk about theology and that we just love it, love it, love it. Nobody loves the Bible more than me. But the foundation of my faith is not a book. It's a person. That's what Paul said. And the authority is Jesus. That's what Jesus said. So, as the Bible goes, Christianity doesn't go. The skeptics have it wrong. Unfortunately, most Christians have it wrong. The people who walked away had it wrong, and we together are going to get it right. It's not as the Bible goes, so goes Christianity. It's as Jesus goes, so goes Christianity, or Christianity goes. And if you want to know how Jesus goes, don't cross-examine the Bible. That's what skeptics do. To take down Christianity, you'll need to cross-examine a list of people and a list of unexplainable events. You don't cross-examine the Bible. You have to start with a document called Matthew and ask Matthew, where did all this intricate detail come from? And when you're finished with Matthew and you're able to write Matthew off, the game has just begun, because then you got to wrestle with Mark, who tradition says got his information from the Apostle Peter. And once you've discounted Mark, you're just getting started. Then you got to go to Luke, who said, I thoroughly investigated all these things. Then you got to go to John, who lived to be an old man. And when you're done with John, then you got to take on Peter. Then you got to take on James. Did I mention that James is the brother of Jesus? Did I mention he was stoned illegally and he went to his grave believing his brother was his Lord? Before you discount Christianity, you got to wrestle with James. And then if you get through all that, which you won't, then you're confronted with the Apostle Paul, who's smarter than you can ever imagine being. The Apostle Paul, who said, whoa, hang on. I was a proponent of first century Judaism, and I became a Jesus follower. I have been there and I have done that. And I have spent time with Peter, and I have spent time with John, and I have spent time with the other apostles, and I've been to Jerusalem, and I'm telling you, God has done something among us, and the entire Old Covenant was pointing to this period of time, and this man Jesus rose from the dead. And after you've taken on each one of those individually, then you have some more explaining to do. You've got to explain the survival of the church, sandwiched between, again, empire and temple. You realize the first people that launched the persecution of the church wasn't Rome, it was the temple. How in the world did the church survive all of that? Why is Rome full of crosses? Why is Jerusalem filled with Christian tourists? You have to explain that. Then, once you get through that, you've got to explain Jesus' extraordinarily detailed account of the destruction of the temple. How in the world did he give that much detail to something that was actually going to happen that was considered impossible when he made the prediction? Why is there no mention of the four-year Jewish war between Rome and the people of Israel in any of the Gospels or in any of the literature of the New Testament? Why is there no mention of the destruction of the temple in any of the Gospels or any of the documents of the New Testament? Because it hadn't happened yet. These documents weren't written 100 years after the fact. They were written while the temple was still standing. You got to explain all of that. You can have Genesis. You can have Leviticus, you can have Exodus, you can have Revelation and Philemon, you can have 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, just give me 2 Gospels and 1st Corinthians, game on. Jesus rose from the dead. That's where we anchor our faith, and that's where we must anchor the faith of the next generation. And for the record, and we're going to talk about this a lot in our next series, we don't take those documents, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, 1st Corinthians, Romans, all of them. We do not take those documents seriously because they're in the Bible. This is something that is this so undermines the credibility of our faith. This makes us such easy targets. We don't take those books seriously because they're in the Bible. These documents were included in the Bible because early Christians took them seriously. This generation needs to understand that. So, after years of modeling this and trying to figure out how to get this right and leading you to a more substantial, firm faith, I wrote Irresistible for the rest of the world. And the reason I was able to do that is because you, as a group of churches, an expanding group of churches all over the country, actually all over the world, you have never taken your eye off the ball as to why we do this. You have never allowed this to become just about you and your convenience. You've never lost sight of the fact that this was never about us to begin with. This was never about you to begin with. This was about the you next to you at work, the you next to you at school, the you next to you on the bus, the you next to you in the classroom. And speaking of us, here's what Jesus said about us. Would you like to know what Jesus said about you? Here's what he said at the very end, in the same speech where he said, all authority belongs to me. He said, talking about himself, I will be with you always to the very end of the age. And do you know who you is? Those who are on mission with him. So 23 years ago, we set out to be on mission to the best of our ability with our Savior for the sake of the world. And you have been so faithful to create on-ramps for skeptics and on-ramps for people who've walked away from faith and on-ramps for people who have questions. Together, we have become a community of irresistible people with a message that's practically impossible that's difficult to resist. And so for those of you who I've had the privilege of partnering with for many, many years, I can't say thank you enough for extending your trust to me when I'm not always clear and we try things that don't always work. Thank you. For those of you who are brand new, I'm telling you, we need you to engage not for your sake, but for the sake of this culture and for the sake of this next generation. Because more than ever, all of us time and all these t-shirts and all this volunteering and all of this money, it's really not about us. Because whether we want to admit it or not, and whether we can tell from looking around our communities, the church is losing. So for the sake of the generation, somebody's got to get it right. We've got to get it right. When I talk to church leaders in other parts of the country, I always try to end with this question. Here's what I say, because they're looking at me like, I don't know, and that's too hard, I don't know, and the deacons and the elders, and we don't do it that way, and we have to paint everything. And I'm like, okay. Let me just end with this. What is the faith of the next generation worth? And I just let it hang. And then I look at them and I say, it's worth everything. Great churches are characterized by three things. People who love Jesus. People who love like Jesus. And here's what makes you extraordinary. People with a plan to ensure the next generation is introduced to the love of Jesus. And that's who you are. And that's what you've done. Let's do it some more. Heavenly Father, thank you for our churches. Thank you for these fabulous people who just get it and who give and who serve and who sacrifice and who show up early. I pray that your hand of blessing would be on us for another round, because we want to partner with you and we want to drag, if we have to, the American church back onto the fertile soil that says, fact check us, we dare you. But you'll have to wrestle with Matthew and then Mark and then Luke and then John and then Peter and then James and then Paul, and there are still more questions to answer. So help us to get our generation there, because we have the greatest story in the world, and it's a story for the world. And we pray this in the matchless name of Jesus. Amen. We'll see you all next week.
That was so nice to hear Andy's heart, how much he loves Jesus, the Bible, and his care for the next generation. So we have one question for us all before we leave today to help us process what we just heard. And here it is. If someone were to ask you why you believe in Jesus, what would you say? Is the foundation of your faith it is written, or something happened? What's important about the difference between the two? For me, it has to be that something happened, the event of Jesus' death and resurrection, because obviously there were Christians long before the Bible existed. But how I know that all happened is because of two things: the Bible being written for us here today, and my personal experience with God, from my devotional and prayer times to God showing up in my life in big ways. I think my takeaway from this message is that to reach the future generations, our approach needs to be different. And that's why I'm very excited about what Mosaic is doing. We are trying to find a uniquely better way of doing church. You walk in, you realize it's still church, but it's just a better way of doing it. It's uniquely better. That's all we've got for today. Have a blessed weekend, everyone. God bless.